Float around out there and walk around as they're talking, because this has the feel, the setting of a confirmation hearing. So, and there's a few in the room that I'm looking at that like to ask a lot of questions. So we want to get to those questions and really make this a dialogue and not a lecture. I hope you enjoyed some of the pictures we saw up there on the screen. It is all about the connective tissue of our Navy, but the active reserve and civilian side of the Navy, and that is our people. They're the ones that are going to take us to that next level, to leap ahead, if you will, of what technology brings to the Navy. And if we're going to stay ahead of our adversaries, and by the way, if you read a lot of what's being written out there by some of our potential adversaries, they are recognizing that we have a huge asymmetric advantage in our people, and they're spending a lot of time trying to figure out how we do it so that they can catch up to us. And we're just not going to let that happen. And the way we're not going to let it happen is by accelerating our ability to learn as we go and not get in our own way, which we have a propensity to do over time. And what you'll see and hear from the folks at this table, I think, is some of the things we've been working on for the last several months, if not years, to try to continue to bring in great people. And we do have extraordinary talent in the Navy today. So let me quickly introduce a great panel. And like I said, they represent some interesting and important aspects of the Navy as it's evolving. We'll start with Vice Admiral Robin Braun, who's our Chief of Naval Reserve, going on 4 years in the job, commands 60,000 reservists that support our Navy, and has been doing that during her tenure, but long before that as a 1-2 star and even 06 since the 9/11 tragedy that hit our country. The reserves came in very, very strong to support the active force in many different ways. And so we've learned a lot more about that integration and the necessary integration between active and reserves over the last 14, 15 years of combat. So she'll have a lot to share with us about what she needs looking into the future to help continue to support the active side. Sitting next to her is Vice Admiral Jan Tighe, the commander of 10th Fleet. And you want to talk about a workforce that is the least understood in our Navy, and I'll be perfectly frank on this. It's not part of your typical warfighting edge that we talk about in terms of aviation, surface, subsurface kind of capability, but every single one of us that are from those communities have awoken to the idea that we're not going to be able to fight in the future unless we get this part of our ability to communicate and act in electronic space, unless we do it well. So key to that, central to that, is hiring great people, bringing up great people, training, and then being able to operate. So Jan's got a lot to share with you on that front, and I'm sure she's looking forward to your questions. Sitting next to Jan is Rear Admiral Mike White, who is the commander of our Naval Education Training Command in Pensacola. This is the guy who takes, if you will, street to fleet. The kids that come out of boot camp, principally in our enlisted force, they come out of boot camp and start entering all the training tracks that leads to them walking aboard a ship on a pier or on the flight line with our aviation squad and submarines, so on and so forth. He has been a very, very active change agent in the way we have viewed the way we train in a very non-traditional sense for the Navy in the future. We've got a lot going on that aspect, and I think he'll be able to shine some light on the kind of technologies, the man-machine interfaces that we're looking for to accelerate that learning into the future. And immediately next to my right here, your left, is Rear Admiral Bob Burke, who's been the head of our policy shop in N1. So he's the guy, he's the poet in the room. He writes all the policies and makes all these wonderful ideas come to life. And it's a tough job because it spans the full spectrum of what we do in recruiting, retention, developing, retiring, following, and in many respects, leading the force from a human capital perspective. So Bob's got a lot of great insight and experience on that as well. So what I'd ask each one of them to do in kind of the order I introduced you is kind of give it an opening remark, a set of remarks, and then we'll get right to questions. Robin, over to you.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. And First, to talk about the reserve component, part of that total force that is today's Navy, our 60,000 men and women are both full-time and part-time, and of course, some of them, the majority of them, are prior service. Many of them are direct commission or coming in straight off the street, so being recruited into the Navy. But important to point out that the purpose of the reserve component is to have a flexible, adaptable workforce that is trained and ready to be recalled in any kind of force package that we need, whether it's one individual, whether it's a whole squadron or battalion, or whether it's maybe a detachment. And so the importance of having sailors that are ready to go at all times is absolutely critical to what we do. Now, I brought up the fact that some are prior service and some are coming directly into the Navy from the civilian populace, and so that provides two very important aspects of what the reserve component brings. First, the training and experience that's given when they serve on active duty, and so we spend thousands of dollars to train these personnel, and some will make the decision to go to the civilian workforce. So very important that we capitalize on that training and that experience and keep them in our force in a part-time status, keep a certain number of them in the force. At the same time, we also bring people from the civilian sector into the Navy Reserve, and they bring significant civilian skills. And so that might be chaplains, that might be doctors, nurses, dentists, it may be cybersecurity experts. And so there are many people out there that have significant civilian skills that can assist the Navy. And bringing them in a part-time status is a way to increase the effectiveness of the total force. I'll tell you that for us, communications are critical. And so as we look at technology today, it's very, very, very important that we have systems and processes and tools so that we can communicate with those reserve sailors, and so that every minute that they spend dedicated to the Navy is value added. And so we're looking at a number of different ideas that can be utilized across all of the Navy, not just in the reserve component, but things like mobile app, using your own personal device for communications as opposed to being on a Navy computer. And so we can talk a little bit more about that as we have this discussion. But again, very critical that we've got the communications, the training for a distributed workforce, because our sailors reside all across the nation. So you go to Grand Forks, or you go to, someplace in North Dakota, down on the border in Arizona, you've got reserve sailors. So being able to train them there within their reserve center, within their NOSC, is important. And so some of the things that Admiral White is doing at NETSI will be very value added to that distributed workforce that we have, so they can be trained and ready so that when they go to the fleet to support the fleet, they're ready to go. But I look forward to your questions and to further discussion on some of the ideas. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, good afternoon, post-lunch. at Fleet Cyber Command and the 10th Fleet, we have forces deployed globally around the world, and I am the operational commander for a portion of the information warfare capabilities that the United States Navy enjoys. Those capabilities include, obviously, the cyber, largest part of the cyber operations workforce, the signals intelligence workforce, and to some degree, the electronic warfare and IO workforce. And what I find in that workforce is that, again, different than what you see in other warfare areas, the talent that our workforce brings to the fight every day is quite often a lot less important about what rank they happen to be or what they may be wearing to work every day. So I have, in some cases, E4s contributing greatly to the fight on the network every day, or civilian partners in the space, helping to inform maneuvers in cyberspace that we need to do to avoid adversaries on our networks. We have reserve units aligned to all of my operational commanders, and we have a great partnership with the reserves to be able to surge and flow forces in both exercise and operations. And I think one of the critical, interesting aspects of this workforce is that, you know, many of them have technician in their name, particularly on our enlisted side of the house. And in a lot of times they think of themselves as technical and technicians. And the reality is they're our operational capability. They are what makes us have the advantage over other adversaries. Technology is our terrain. Technology is the space that we operate in. We have responsibilities of bringing them and kitting them out with tools to make them more successful. But our asymmetric advantage and our operational capability is in those human beings. And so having them understand that and come to work every day excited and recognize, even in the enlisted force, you know, as they progress through the ranks, experience is gonna help them be more effective in this space. But I need them to, you know, stay operationally focused, even and especially into the chief petty officer ranks. And so as we have folks graduating the chief petty officer ranks, we have them transition into leading sailors. We have to have them leading in both operations and in leading sailor programs. And I think that's something that we've conveyed to our operational force and how we grow and develop all of our force to stay operationally relevant, I think is a big important area for us. And so, and the last piece I would say that I think is maybe not so unique to the information warfare force or the cyber force is the notion of innovation. And you've heard of us talk a lot about it, you know, over the last couple of days. And I think growing leaders that know how to actually embrace innovation, how to cultivate it, how to accelerate it into our operational capabilities is something I think that we have an opportunity to work on here, because we are interested in doing it, but going from interested to actually all being able to empower your folks to innovate, empower innovative relationships with industry and others is a whole nother thing. So developing our leaders to cultivate innovation is another area I think we'd be very interested in pursuing. Thank you.
Thanks, yeah. Mike?
Good afternoon. As Admiral Moran said, I'm in our individual skills training branch for just about every rating out there except for nuclear power and medical and our special operators. And so I think we're at a point today where we can inspire career-long learning using mobile modular technology. I would argue today that our training is very effective. You know, we do a lot of it in a brick-and-mortar-centric environment, but it's a pretty powerful blend of instructor-based, computer-based, and lab-based training. So skills are taught and then reinforced in a laboratory or training environment. It works pretty well for us, but it's very brick-and-mortar-centric, reinforced by mobile training teams and groom teams and so forth. But because of that, it also becomes very constrained in time and availability. And so our sailors are offered the opportunity to get many learning experiences, but it can often be at the schedule that we provide as NETSI, not necessarily on the demand that they're looking for. And so I'm looking to transition us to a more mobile and modular environment, and it's perhaps best illustrated in a couple of examples. I would submit to you that there are complex maintenance tasks that we teach in our schools today, but they're not performed very often in the fleet. And we don't provide the opportunity today for the sailors to rehearse those when the time comes. It may be something taught and rehearsed in the schoolhouse. Years later, they're asked to do it in the fleet. And so today, the technology is really emerging that they could have a visualization tool or even a demonstration video or an avatar-based instruction that allows them to mission rehearse, if you will, before they perform this complex task. In a similar sense, if there's an operational capability, running an air control or a sonar display as an individual, that you might not have the opportunity to do for a period of time. Either your ship was in maintenance, perhaps you were deployed and not operating in that particular warfare area. It'd be great to have a ability to refresh an individual before they got back into a team and started training with these mobile training teams and groom teams and so forth. We have virtual world technology that would allow us to export a simulation with an instructor to a sailor anywhere in the world. and allow them to refresh themselves on their individual part of the task before they get back into team training, whatever time that might be most beneficial to them. I think another idea might be as we update software and systems, it can take us in the organization a long time to build the technical training equipment to accompany that. If we've gone to a more mobile and modular way of delivering training, it's just a few lines of code to update that and allow our sailors to actually realistically see what they're going to operate on. I would tell you that's kind of in the professional side. In the personal side, I think there's a lot to be gained by investing in our sailors there as well. I'm talking about apps. You know, we've got 10 so far that are out there to support our sailors. Many of them are for required training, our GMT for various topics. But I'm very proud of the fact that we're moving forward in credentialing online, so allowing our sailors to get civilian credentials for the things they've learned to do in the Navy. And also, we call them life skills, but helping them understand what the services provide, the Department of Defense services, in terms of car loans, house loans, all those life-changing events that we want them to be able to navigate through successfully to become a more powerful sailor in the workplace. So I think, as you will see on the floor, as was discussed by Admiral Moran, the technology is out there today. We're seeing it. It's real, it's relevant, and it's attractive to the young men and women because it's on the devices they use every day in their personal lives. So I think we're really at the cusp here. I would tell you we're very much on the ground floor. I have a lot to learn, as does our organization, about how to best apply this. But the opportunity is here, and we're excited about moving it forward. So I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Bob?
Thank you. It's good to be here this afternoon. Our fleet manning is in relatively good shape. It's, in fact, at a historical high over recent years. We're at our 107th consecutive month of meeting our recruiting mission, thanks to the good work done by Admiral Hughes and his team at Recruiting Command. And our retention is relatively high. But a few years ago, we knew that as we worked our way through some fleet manning challenges, that we would have challenges if the market turned again. We had a really good view of where we had been, but we couldn't forecast the future accurately and see those trends. And we had, we knew that we would have some challenges in terms of competing with the talent market. With our increasingly high-tech ships, sailors that would require increasingly high-tech skills, that we would in fact be competing with industry for the exact same talent. So Admiral Rand set us on a course to overhaul our personnel systems, and we initially started out with about 84 different initiatives. That's now kind of consolidated down to about 48 or so. That we collectively refer to as Sailor 2025. One part of that Sailor 2025 effort is the discussion you just heard from Admiral White, getting the right sailors with the right skills on all those ships, submarines, aircraft squadrons, and expeditionary units. But there are two other aspects of it. One of them we lump under a level of effort called personnel system modernization. The second one is an effort to improve our already rich culture, and I'll talk a little bit about each of those two here in just a minute. But under the personnel system modernization, it's really an effort to get to data-driven analytics, improve our ability to match an individual's talents to the jobs that they go into, which ultimately should result in better performance on the job and better retention throughout a career. We're looking at issues like tailored compensation, paying individuals not only on a particular skill set, but how well they perform that skill set, what locations they might be willing to go to, some of our more challenging manning locations, for example, or if they want to trade maybe a little bit of pay for geographic stability because they're putting their children through high school, things of that nature. In order to do all those sorts of things, we're going to need better, more agile, and more comprehensive evaluation systems. And we're going to need more counseling tools to feed individuals' professional development. We need to have the flexibility to move folks between the active component into Admiral Braun's reserve component, and then if the time is right, move them back into the active component so that we can preserve the investment we made in that training for those folks and bring them back in. And we'd like to be able to offer those individuals career broadening opportunities at residence courses in civilian institutions, tours with industry, companies like Amazon and FedEx, which we're working with today. So that's sort of the large personnel system modernization effort. Under the enriched culture effort, it's really about improving our diversity and inclusion, building our sailors' ability to deal with the rigors of life, making them tougher, helping them to avoid destructive behaviors so that they can succeed throughout a career, and putting things in place to improve life-work balance. So putting things in place so that folks don't have to choose between raising children and a career in the Navy. Things like a career intermission program that allows folks to take 2 to 3 years off in order to do things that they need to do and come back without impact to their promotion and screening opportunities in the future. Increased child care center hours and capacity, maternity leave, and even things that go to health and welfare, like culture of fitness, revised physical fitness assessment standards, nutritional counseling, things of that nature. But all of these things, to do them right and to put ourselves on par with our commercial competitors, requires a comprehensive information technology backbone that we don't have today. That's one of the things that challenged us a few years ago when we couldn't forecast. So we want to get to that data-driven analytic capability that helps us forecast, that helps us target our compensation programs, and helps us put a more customer-friendly service face out to our sailors. And I'm looking forward to your questions. Thanks.
So there are microphones on either side here. As I kick things off with a couple of questions, if you've got some comments or questions, I invite you to go to the microphone. And I would encourage in comments as well, just your thoughts on what you heard up here and as this conversation develops, any other thoughts you might have. So there's been a lot written in the last 5 to 10 years on these people called millennials. And they're kind of strange looking. They've got tattoos in different places. They never look at you in the eye. They've always got their head down. They're texting. I'm looking at my good friend Sakaguchi over there who does this all the time. But you're not a millennial, my friend. You're something else. But I think the point I'm trying to make here is that we see a shift going on in our generational leadership turnover in the Navy and in every sector of service and companies around the globe. So we were asking ourselves all the time, well, what's it mean? And are we ready for them to turn over the control of the Navy, if you will, to give them the controls into the future with the system that we grew up in? So all of us here grew up with Gen Xers and Boomers, for the most part, and some of the greatest generation. And then it's started to shift about 10 years ago. 5 years ago, we had 25% of the force was what we would affectionately call millennials. 9 short years from now, there'll be 5% of us in the Navy and 95% of millennials / the next generation, whoever they are, whatever they look like. That's a big shift in just the demographic makeup of the United States and the world. So I'd ask each member, as you look at your portfolios and what you just described, what do you think about that shift, and how should we respond, and what are we doing in your respective worlds to either take full advantage of that? Do you see opportunity in it? Do you see threat in it? Or do you see more of the same, they're just going to kind of fit into who we are today? Robin, you want to start?
So I just see a great opportunity here with our millennials, and with when you look at what they say millennials, how many jobs they'll have before they're 35, what do they say, maybe 7-8 jobs before they're 35. And so people want to do a job for a couple years, maybe they go back to school for a couple years, they want to do this back and forth. It's not like it used to be where you go and you stay at a company for 30 years or 40 years and you get the gold watch and you go home, or necessarily where you come to the Navy and you stay for 30 years and then you go home. There are people who come into the Navy, they get great skills and training, and then maybe they say, I want to go to Harvard Business School. Maybe they do a career intermission plan. Maybe they decide, I'm going to go do that, start my own business, and become part of the reserves. And then at some point, maybe they say, I want to go back on active duty. And I'll tell you, we were just down in Richmond on Saturday visiting reserves, and I met AO1 Booker. And AO1 Booker is obviously an aviation ordnanceman, but just a week or so ago, we put out a call for Master at Arms. So active component Navy is short of Master at Arms, and so we put out a gov delivery email, and so that's what technology is doing for us. We send out this email and we say, the Navy needs MAs. Anybody interested in coming back on active duty, you know, please respond. So AO1 Booker responded and said, I'm willing to leave my job as a police officer and come back into the Navy and change my rating to MA, which is what I've been training for the past however many years he's been in the active component. So he's coming back on to fill a shortage in the active component Navy. And I see this happening all across the Navy in many different ratings. And it's very exciting to see because AO1 Booker will come back into the Navy and bring skill sets that he learned from his civilian job. So I see that with our millennials, that this is something they're going to want to be able to do, is to be able to serve in the Navy active duty, maybe go part-time in the reserves for a while, and then potentially come back and serve. It could be for the rest of his career, or it could be just for maybe a year or two. But I think that those opportunities are very important to millennials. They want to have opportunities to have a different career, to do school opportunities, to start a business. And so I think that technology has really enabled us to be able to do that in the future. And we have to take advantage of it.
Jan, I got to believe you're keenly interested in this next generation. What do you think?
Yes, and I think I agree with everything. I do agree with everything Vice Admiral Braun has just said about seeing it as opportunity. I do think there is risk that if we don't manage the force properly, that if we don't meet expectations of what quality of even service looks like, which is quality of life, then you know we risk losing the very talent we're trying to retain. And so in some instances, what I've been seeing, particularly among the information warfare workforce, they are very interested in growing their skills and then applying their skills in mission. And they would be happy to stay on mission for as long as we would let them stay on mission. And so we have multiple different types of mission for various ratings to do, multiple work roles across the cyber spectrum, across the SIGINT spectrum, across electronic warfare, and managing their expectations with respect to being able to continue to contribute and do what they do, while recognizing their interest in doing career intermission programs, getting additional education, investing in whatever non-brick and mortar types of education are available for them. I think they are very, very interested in that. And so I see it all as opportunity. In the managing expectations space, we have been working the idea and piloting an effort on aptitude testing, particularly in cyber. And the idea there is multifaceted. It's a lot like how we aptitude test linguists who haven't been taught a language yet. So it's recognizing that they may not have the knowledge base or the skill base for cyber operations, but that there may be an aptitude that's there based on their critical thinking skills or their preferences in working in different work roles. And so we're piloting this effort to be able to, one, identify the right people to bring into the workforce, better identify, but also potentially track them into areas that they would be most interested in working. The differences in how a system administrator works today compared to an on-net operator, those are wildly different things, and they're all part of the cyber workforce. So if we can identify aptitude and interest, in particular jobs, ASVAB does a bit of that, and combining the two, I think will help us be successful in retaining the talent we're looking for.
Magway, I got to believe, you know, we've had some conversations about gaming technology that kind of can take us to another level in terms of how we train and how young kids today learn. And you could argue it's not just the young kids today because the technology is advanced. Can you talk a little bit about what you're seeing and trying to go after in that technological realm that'll improve the way we train and learn as a Navy?
Yes, sir. So, you know, one of the traits that we believe we see in the millennials is a desire to be as individual as they can in their training. In other words, they are not interested in everybody starting on Monday morning at block one and finishing Friday afternoon at block 10. They want to proceed at a pace that's comfortable to them. And what some of this gaming technology allows is for them to do just that. So, you know, gaming is maybe a good way to call it a visualization. The first-person game visualization is probably the most readily available. So you proceed in this, and it is the inside of a ship, for example, and you are tasked to do certain things in that ship, PMS or preventive maintenance, for example, and you proceed through that game at your own pace. And it measures your ability to complete those tasks correctly. If you don't, you have to go back and redo it again. But it is now a control that you as the individual have to move at a pace you're comfortable with while learning the skills that this can teach you, because you are actually in a very much a mission rehearsal kind of mode through the gaming system. And there are opportunities to bring avatars into the gaming that make it more realistic or provide another level of training that doesn't necessarily require an instructor in the classroom. If you think a little bit about some of our soft skills, it applies very much the same as well. If you are trying to teach somebody counseling for even the most dire circumstances, suicide prevention, for example, or just career counseling, having a perhaps an avatar-based game that allows you to participate multiple times, reps and sets, is a way to build skills that we can't necessarily do it by role-playing, which is typical in our classrooms today. So the technology has emerged. I mean, you can visualize it, you see it all the place in electronic stores. Now, if we can tie that to actual learning and motivate the sailors to do so, I think it'll be very effective, particularly for this generation.
Yeah, so one of the things we're challenged with when we talk to the fleet about what's most important to commanders in the fleet and sailors out there is we've eaten up all of their time to be able to train to be warfighters. We've got so many demands on our time for general military training, in the scope and breadth of that training that's mandated by folks outside the Navy, but also within the Navy, is huge. And when you stack it with old technology, i.e. PowerPoint slides in an auditorium with 300 people from the ship, the squadron, or whatever in there, they're asleep almost as fast as you all are sleeping right now. And we have to reach them in a medium in which we can capture several aspects of that training simultaneously. And I think the gaming piece, if you construct it right and you design it right, you actually get it a lot more of those general military training skills than you do almost anything else. So that's the area that we see the biggest bang for buck. Every minute you give back to commanders to spend time leading and training to be warfighters is a huge advantage to us in terms of our effectiveness at sea. So Bob, from your perspective, this millennial thing is interesting in that they're online a lot more than, well, we didn't even have the opportunity to be online, so I guess maybe there's advantages and disadvantages to that. But the fact that they're online a lot means there's a lot of data out there about this generation that is otherwise untapped. So Jeff Hughes is going to talk in a following session about how he's using that data to try to understand where the pockets of propensity to serve are. But there's also other things in that data that I think, you know, you just described kind of this transformation that we're trying to make in terms of analytics. Do you want to expound on that in terms of this generation?
Sure. Thanks, sir. Again, I think that the entire body of work that we're doing under Sailor 2025 is really aimed at the millennials' desire for choices, flexibility, and desire for involvement in the processes. So, you know, that is how we're addressing that risk. But I think there's also opportunity in it in terms of how they see their how they see their career opportunities, and really when it comes down to it, they want their basic needs taken care of. They want to have an input into decisions. They want to know that their decisions are valued and making a difference, and they want to have an opportunity for career progression, and that's something that the Navy has historically and traditionally done well. Our leadership teams do well at that. The challenge will be bringing that up in a venue and with mechanisms that help bring the worst ship up to the standard of the strongest ship. So I think there are a number of things that we can do in terms of our leadership training, in terms of the tools that our leaders use to develop their subordinates. And this would apply not just to the sailors, but to the civilians on our Navy team as well, and how we do that. So I haven't really answered Admiral Moran's question yet, but there are some applications for some of those data mining efforts to really inform how we reach those individuals on training. I see more of the applicability of that, though, as to how we would learn how to really build, for example, tailored compensation packages like a company would do. I would value education more over an increased paycheck, for example. I would value the opportunity to stay here and get my children through high school or college more than increased pay. Or I'm very mobile, I don't need those other things, I've done them on my time, giving more pay. So tailored compensation would be one aspect. Again, Admiral Hughes will talk in detail. I think the most immediate application here would be in understanding the markets, who's got that interest in serving, and then how to make them aware of the opportunities, how to reach those individuals and make them aware of the opportunities. So multiple avenues there, leadership development, how we are talking to the sailors as customers. Again, they operate at the speed of warfare when they're out at sea, and then they come into port and want to deal with a pay issue or talk to their detailer about their next assignment, and they can't use their iPad or their iPhone to do it. They've got to go do it through this 1970s state-of-the-art technology system. And that system sort of leads them to believe they can't see all the choices, and it works against our efforts to be transparent, and therefore they feel like they're not getting the whole truth. So we'll need those systems to enable that transparency, let them see it all, let them have that involvement in the processes, let them make the trades, let them see what trades are available in their career choices, and I think we will show the commitment to their individual desires and needs that will make them want to stay Navy.
Thanks, Bob. Yes, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon. Dave Hart from Deloitte. The common theme today clearly has been the desire to be much more porous when a sailor moves from active to reserve, and consequently reserve clearly has a second real-time job in the workplace. Coincident with that is the ability to recognize continual training both inside the Navy and elsewhere, and be able to recognize or rationalize those types of training together so that an individual, as he or she moves back and forth, has built up a recognized accreditation or certification that works both in the Navy, we call it an NEC perhaps, or in the workplace so that they understand what they've got transports across that workspace.
Yeah. Anybody want to comment on that, Mike?
Sure. This is, I think, one of the loftier, far-reaching goals that we have. But today, our training is tied very closely to our NEC, our Navy Enlisted Classification System. So a training course that you take earns you a code that goes in your record that gives you a skill set that you're expected to use on your ship or squadron, whatever it might be. As we try to break that training down into these modules so that our best sailors are ready to progress to the next level, an NEC model may be a little bit antiquated or a little bit clunky to make that process happen. And so, sir, what we often think about is how do we match up in a way that fits our Navy readiness model and the skill sets that are recognized in the civilian sector and link those two up so that we give credit or understand what somebody might bring from an outside work into some of the skills that we need, either to save us in training or recognize what they have and put them right to work. It is out there probably a little beyond the scope of what we're immediately attacking, but certainly something we've got to get after.
I would just add, you do have a silver lining here with the cybersecurity workforce. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what we're doing in terms of Navy COOL and getting certifications for the information assurance cybersecurity workforce paid for, and they're forced to maintain those as they go forward. So that's the good news. That's where a clear certification on cybersecurity can transcend both the civilian and the Navy need. So that's one bright spot there. Give yourself credit.
And I would also say that it's important for the Department of Defense to have a civilian employment database that we can collect what reserve sailors bring, the skill sets they bring. Right now, all we have is a database that has a drop-down menu. And so what we've been advocating to DOD for all of the Guard and Reserve is to have a database where you could put in a civilian resume so you could capture all those certifications and qualifications that people had through their civilian jobs, and then you could data mine, you could go in and you could keyword search to find skill sets that people had. And that way, if you had a job that you needed done, you could go out, search this database, and find those personnel that had that skill set available to them. I'll also tell you a story about a DOD dog handler who wanted to get the same qualification within the Navy, but was turned down because he didn't have time to keep the Navy skill set of dog handling up. And so they said, you're a reserve, you can't keep the skill set up. He said, I do that in my job for Department of Defense, but because of the way that we have set up that NEC, he's not able to do it. So there are things like that that are inconsistent. So we need to find ways to not make everything so stovepipe that you have to fit within these walls. And so that's what NETSI is doing right now, looking at the way that we train and how we give certifications and qualifications. And that will help, I think.
And another piece we're working on in the modernization of the personnel system is an integrated pay and personnel system that's common to both the active and reserve component. Our systems can't talk to each other today. You know, I had a reserve officer at work for me that was on active duty for special work, and an error was made at the personnel support detachment, and a button wasn't pushed. She came into work, and her ID card showed as expired, and she no longer existed as a person in the United States Navy. It took her 2 days to get back in the system again. So we're working to fix that with this integrated pay and personnel system, which will have fields to allow us to capture things like outside experience. We don't have to look between two systems. We really are a total force that's integrated, and we can mix and match those talents and bring them to bear at the right times.
Admiral Sekiguchi, thanks for
thanks, sir,
for joining us.
Good afternoon, sir. Thank you much for the great panel. And I have a couple of questions. And the first one is, sorry my Tokyo accent, but if you don't understand, please tell me. Maybe I can make you like, you know, with a New York accent though. So the first question is relating to the like a cyber in the area. Our Navy as well is really hard time to the train, educate those skill sets that are the specialists to deal with the cyber warfare. And there are a couple of challenges. The one challenge is how to recruit the talented people from a civilian world. The second, the ones we recruit, the successfully recruit, and train them, educate them, and it fits into the top-notch, the cyber warrior. But once they reach that point, there is a lot of demand, the job opportunity for the civilian world, and we have a really hard time to keep them retained in our Navy forces. So is there any like a miracle, like a, you know, the way to keep them, or how to deal with those challenges in the U.S. Navy? That is one question. And the second question is relating to the mobile training, the method that your Navy is introducing in your system. Our Navy is getting up the increasing up tempo. It's really hard to send those sailors to the certain period of time in the school or like a mission oriented like a schooling or whatever, to remove them to the shore, institution to educate them. So, how to deal with those educational needs and operation tempo that keep the balance, and if it is possible that like a network, education networking system, and be able to make the given the education to the sailor at sea while they are deploying. Is there any method or the way to doing those kind of remote distance learning system that U.S. Navy might employing that your education system, sir? Thank you, sir.
Thanks for the questions. Magway, you want to take the second question first, and we'll work back?
Sure.
Good?
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
So, Admiral, you bring up a great point that we can be mobile and modular very easily ashore, but when you embark, it becomes very difficult to do so with bandwidth and other requirements. We have some solutions today where we place servers on the ships with the training material aboard, and you can still access it. But there's a latency issue. We can't update them as often as you might imagine. And we want sailors that take the training to be able to register their credit. And so the couple avenues we're exploring are just that, improve the way we can transport information to these learning management systems aboard our ships, or deployed overseas, if you will. And so we can offer the same type of training, just perhaps delivered differently, either in a closed system on a ship, for example, but be able to replicate the credits and analytics that we're collecting anywhere else. We're early on in that. The submarine community has a submarine onboard trainer, a system of laptops that works fairly successfully, and we're trying to maybe replicate that model for other communities as at least a place to start. But it is a consideration we are taking into account that we can't be shore-centric in our training for a deployable force. So plenty of work to do in moving that forward, but your question is very well received.
Bob or Robin or Jan, either one of you want to try the first question?
I'll take a shot at this. Okay. How do you retain the cyber workforce? I think certainly the demand is high. And as I suggested before, I think our sailors are the happiest when they're on mission. So, getting them efficiently, effectively onto the mission that we've trained them for, and keeping them well employed. I mean, there are missions that they get to do inside the United States Navy they can do nowhere else legally. So they might be able to make more money, but maybe within the government. But they might have an opportunity to make more money elsewhere, but it's the nature of the work is different. And so sort of the patriotic desire to serve your country and making sure they understand the significance of what they are doing at every level, is one aspect of, them understanding their operational role, how they fit in to a strategic plan, how they fit into the CNO's campaign design, on a daily basis and making it real. That's an aspect of it. And then how we manage them as a workforce from taking their skill sets and letting them do successive tours in that skill set to the innovative ideas that and programs that CMP and the team have implemented, I think those are all critically important to letting them see that they can have the career that they want and the life that they want inside the Navy and continue to serve.
Thanks.
And if I can add to that, and if they do decide that they want to go out and work for industry, in many cases, they still want to serve part-time. They love wearing the uniform, they love representing the nation, and they love being part of a team with a mission. And in many cases, they go out and they realize that the grass isn't always greener on the other side, and that money isn't everything. And so we've got 50,000 men and women who volunteer to serve in addition to their civilian jobs out there. So there's 50,000 people that don't have to do it. They have other jobs, but they've found a family, a mission, a focus with the Navy, and they still want to support in a part-time basis. So I think it's important that we, especially with our cyber personnel, that we let them know we still need them to be on the team in a part-time status.
And I was just going to say, just one C story. I was offered career intermission as a midshipman.
Really?
How crazy is that? The 1984, I was leaving the Naval Academy. And the candidate guidance officer, you'll read about this in Shipmate next month. The candidate guidance officer said, hey, we've got this new program. This is in 1984. I never thought, you know, I never expected it from, you know, the Naval Academy. I said, hey, if you go to the University of Florida and decide the grass isn't greener on the other side, we'll be willing to take you back. And just the knowledge of that kind of flexibility or that opportunity, of course, got me thinking immediately, oh, I won't be able to graduate with my class. And so, I mean, I think, you know, even then, displaying that kind of flexibility and willingness to work with the people inside the Navy, I think is important.
Yes, sir.
Bill, Jim Godwin.
Hey, Jim.
So, you worry me a little bit with stats, 107 months, 25% to go into this larger number. You asked us 2 years ago at the Aviation Flag Symposium, or you asked how many people had family members that were serving in the military, and that pool is getting smaller. And so now I wonder, you know, about what we do about that problem that we've got with 25% of the kids is all we can choose from to start with. So a follow-on to that as well. So what do we do about the first question? The second question is, when we're looking at the millennial kids, maybe we're looking in the wrong place. Should we think about, and I did this in another company, where the culture was to look for college-age students to be able to be the interns. But we had a relationship with Cyber Patriot on the cyber side to bring high school kids in. And so now when I hired three college students from, you know, from great places around town here, and then I got Chantilly Academy and TJ here in town, I had five high school students that overshadowed the three college students. And so now do we need to go down into the primary and secondary education areas and find out what they're doing education-wise to flow up to what we ultimately want them to start shaping the way we do in business, to shape the environment below us for what we ultimately want it to be so that pool of 25% gets bigger?
Yeah, I'll take that question starting, and then Jeff Hughes might want to jump in and help. But the second part of your question, we're doing quite a bit of outreach exactly to that point. We do a lot of science, technology, engineering, and math engagement at even down to the middle school level. Jeff has road teams that go out and make regular circuits, you know, with a strategic plan and engage in the right places at the right time to, you know, help smart kids make that linkage between furthering their education in those areas and then what the Navy can offer later on. So we're planting those seeds, making that investment. We would like to be able to do more of that, and Jeff's got plans that I'm sure he'll talk about when he gives his presentation later that talks about our ideas to expand that and perhaps do it a little bit better. The other part of your question was about our lack of diversity with respect to military bloodlines, and that is something that's very much on our mind. I think the current statistic is that about 82% of our folks come from some sort of a military bloodline, you know, father, brother, uncle, aunt, cousin, whatever it might be. So, and it's also kind of concentrated in certain states. Again, Jeff can talk a lot more about the efforts that are going on there, but a little bit of it has to do with how we reach folks in areas that don't have a lot of military concentration. You know, the Midwest, by and large, doesn't tend to think much about the United States Navy. They hear what they hear on the news. They don't know a lot about the details. So that sort of thing and those demographics are driving our approach. How do we reach those kids? We're going to have to use some high-tech ways to do it. The data mining that Jeff will talk about later is going to inform how we do it. But frankly, it's through things like video games, access, things of that nature that gets them involved with some sort of a hook to get them to come and look at the rest of the picture. Again, Jeff's got a lot more details. I don't want to steal his thunder, but both those points are very much on our mind, and we've got activities oriented towards improving it.
I just add one more thing. I think you're partnering with ONR, but there are some ONR programs, and one of them I'm very familiar with is down. It was down at Fayetteville State University, and the nature of that program in terms of reaching down lower into primary secondary was to get Fayetteville State, who in this case was working the STEM aspects, but especially some of the cyber things. The faculty have get reimbursable research to work with those younger kids on summer programs and projects, and they start in the ninth grade. And so by starting them in the ninth grade and getting them interested, particularly on the STEM side of the education curve, that that is a great, and they mentor them all the way through high school. Well, some of these ninth graders don't even know what kind of math they should take if they ever want to go into STEM. They don't have that kind of guidance or understanding. So getting then the colleges and universities involved with those younger folks, but then sponsored and tied to Navy and Navy projects, I thought it was a really great model. The idea by ONR was we get this model started and we have other universities pick it up, as seed corn. And so I was just very proud and impressed with that program.
Bill.
Bill Casey with ELG. Admiral White, I loved what you're talking about, using technology for instruction, what you're talking about. Here's my question, though. I'm assuming for those technologies, in each case, someone's doing a detailed task analysis, and then they're doing the training design and then the technology on top of that. There's a body of knowledge, though, I'm thinking about Admiral Tighe's body of knowledge, where the half-life is getting shorter and shorter. Mm-hmm. And it seems like that kind of detailed and careful front-end process is hard to apply to something where it might be changed in 6 months. What's the current thinking on that?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. I would tell you that today, much of our training today, whether we've moved to technology or not, is stepped all the way back to an occupational standard that we would expect a machinist mate or a gunner's mate to have. And then we translate that into jobs, duties, tasks, and then analyze those into what should be trained. It is bounded in good science of education, but it is unwieldy and extremely long to do. And so just as you describe, as those occupational standards evolve pretty quickly and with new types of ships and things coming forward, we think the ability to Once we move this to the higher ends of technology, to manipulate that technology and tighten that loop up will exist. We still will have to keep occupational standards. I mean, that sets the baseline of almost everything, what we recruit to and what we'll bring up to. But within each of those, all the subtasks that come forward, as they migrate and we recognize that doesn't mean you have to buy a new piece of technical training equipment, we think we can get inside that loop. It is a goal, and we're 2 years now. We've got to get it much, much quicker than that. Does that help answer a little bit?
So, Bill, this is a critical point. I mean, technology is moving so fast. The training always lags behind. We are notorious as an institution for delivering new capability without the training. Notorious for it. So part of our requirements documentation and part of the contracting vehicles we use have got to include training up front. What we haven't done yet is build the systems that you can plug that training into without creating a schoolhouse. We can't afford to build schoolhouses all over the country. We got to make this more mobile, modular based that can be delivered anywhere to include a reservist that's not on active duty who wants to stay current to you name the situation. So that is the effort we're trying to do. MAGWI is trying to knock down the barriers to that. We are getting in our own way. And the technology is going to help us. But we also need businesses to be thinking about this with us as opposed to waiting for us to ask for it. It's a clear need that we have to have. Sam.
Admiral Tighe, I have a two-part question. The first is just in general, size of your cyber forces, both active and civilian, is that how does that compare with the missions that you're facing in today's cyber domain? And And the second part is, you know, you had spoken about operationalizing your forces, particularly your more senior personnel. As you do that, of course, you know there's been discussions about bringing in more talented people at a more senior level, say a information warfare officer would be direct commissioned to 05 or 06 based on their skill level, or talented cyber operator would come in as a senior chief. How would that impact your operational effectiveness?
Thank you for the question. First of all, the size of the workforce that I wield, you know, is obviously larger than cyber, but it's about 15,000 people deployed globally, and that includes about 5,000 civilians in that force. With respect to, I think you asked it, how is that enough? I think, is that what you asked? Is that enough? You know, I think the reality is, I don't know that any of us feel like it's enough. I don't want to have more people than I have work for, ever, ever. That's the most unhappy sailor you could ever find, is someone who doesn't have work to do. But when, as it pertains to the cyber mission forces, which has been the growing area, that was intended to be a maneuver force that overlaid what was a pre-existing force that operated and defended our networks. The cyber mission force, what we bought in that 6,000, slightly over 6,000 people across the department that we realigned to the cyber mission force, is really that maneuver element. So these are execution elements. What we did not do is create the command and control structures to command and control those maneuver elements. And so in that regard, we're working very hard with the combatant commands, with U.S. Cyber Command, and with the services to identify the proper command and control elements, because we're doing that basically out of hide that may or may not exist across all the other services. So that's a bit of the focus area right now across the cyber mission force. Your question with respect to potentially being able to move folks in laterally, you know, not from the bottom up. It made me smile only because just this week we were talking about the cyber warfare engineers, which CMP got asked about at our all hands call that he had with us last month. And cyber warfare engineers, for your information, were created based on the image of nuclear power instructors. So we're bringing folks in as O1s for the cyber mission force, principally to be cyber tool developers, weapons developers, if you will. And again, these weapons developers are not, you know, like your acquisition people who sit over in a corner and build something. They're integrated into ops because the space is moving so quickly. And so we have about 24 billets, and we have a structure that's 01 to 03, and we keep them 5 years, and then we, you know, hope that they lateral transfer into one of the other communities, or we hire them on as a civilian, as a tool developer. And so we're thinking through the need for this skill set and what it may require moving forward. Tool developers, there's way more demand than the amount that we have, and so the question becomes, could it be a full community? Where are those requirements? What are the occupational standards that help us identify where those requirements might be? And is there opportunity, you know, today we're bringing the, you know, new college grads basically in as O1s and building them up. Is there opportunity to leverage the type of flexibility that some of the staff corps has to bring people with, you know, very high skill sets in this area, with proven, demonstrated, not just education, but experience in tool development and as software developers, if you will. If they have those experiences, could you bring them in laterally? And, you know, one of the suggestions was maybe we should take them to the staff corps. And I'm like, stop. These people are in operations. And so, you know, why don't we talk about how you would leverage the idea of bringing them in and ask for that as a potential option? So guess what? You guys are going to hear about this all again. but we just had these conversations last week, and I think that your point is well taken. It's certainly feels within the realm of the type of initiatives that the CMP team has been looking for, and I think it would mean a lot operationally to be able to recognize, as I said before, sometimes this is a rank-free zone, and you know, when we're doing operations, what someone's wearing on their collar may not have an implication as to how much expertise or how much fight that they have in them, how much ability they have to deliver in cyber operations or information warfare operations. And so how do we resolve that? Either with incentives or rewards or promotions or bringing them in at the right level to begin with. So I think there's a lot of opportunity there for us.
This idea of lateraling folks in with outside experience, though, at increased pay grades is something that the entire Department of Defense is looking at. You know, we started looking at it closely under Sailor 2025, but now all the services are on board with the idea, and we've asked for some legislative authority to do that, to bring folks in up to the 06 level or up to the E7 level on the enlisted side. So we can do it a little bit in certain very isolated cases, but having that flexibility when Admiral Tighe or another community identifies that need will allow us to be much more agile should the need arise.
And we already do it with doctors and dentists,
right.
Chaplains, so the precedent is already set.
We generally get good reception on that, Sam, except when we talk about Chief Petty Officers. Okay. I got my Fleet Master Chief back there who's just giggling, but we talk about all different ranks and structures, bringing them in, but
yes,
by golly, you got to be a blue shirt before you become a chief. So we got a long way to go on the chief part. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. Lieutenant Commander Brian Johnson. I'm an intel officer at the N51. Quick question that kind of touched on two different topics. The first on recruiting and retention and shifts over to cyber. With a lot of the millennials now being very connected with phones that talk to tablets, that talk to their laptops and other of their friends, is there a concern from the recruiting and retention aspect of keeping those sailors in and getting those sailors to join the Navy where they're going to be taking their devices and going to that are up to date on an operating system and going to an operating system that's years old and is not necessarily as efficient as the devices they have? And then turning to the cybersecurity aspect of it, when I was on the joint staff, one of the things that we tried to implement was using iPads that could have classified information on and give those to the leadership to use those as briefing tools. And a lot of companies today, you see where the employees don't necessarily have desks, they're just tables that are set up. Everybody has laptop computers and they'll come in and they'll sit down in groups of three or four that are working together and they're able to share information. Do you think that the Navy, from a cybersecurity aspect, can get to a point where we can have individuals using those mobile devices or picking up their computers and moving over to other desks and operating without the fear of having that information stolen or hacked?
Is that for me? Are you talking to me?
That part is for you, ma'am. The other part, the retention recruiting, is more for some of the other.
No, I absolutely think, I think it's a fair concern to be worried about, you know, not being able to bring your Fitbit into work, you know, wear it into work because it's got a Wi-Fi in it, not being able to stay connected, you know, to, you know, through your social media accounts, et cetera. And you know, some places are even more stringent than others about that. I think a good solution for that is make sure we don't have old technologies and outdated operating systems as a starting point. And we're actually working on that. But in the same vein, being able to balance sort of on extended deployments, you know, the ability to stay connected socially with the potential risk that gets introduced into, you know, especially if you're on a warfighting platform or any kind of platform forward in the space, I think we have to be able to manage that risk, not avoid the risk, but manage it. And I think that's true with respect to potentially mobility solutions, which is what you were talking about. That was a mobility solution that came out of NSA 4 years ago. But it was an idea that, you know, still hasn't completely been adopted in a way that we're all enjoying it. To be, yes, we should be able to have secure mobile computing. And we should be able to have sailors continue to participate in, you know, social media functions with the proper defenses in place to prevent, you know, any of the potential malware. There's always going to be risk associated with allowing our systems to be connected to the internet. But that's a decision, a policy decision that we have made, recognizing that we won't be able to keep the workforce, you know, that we have, much less be able to recruit a workforce of the future if we completely expect them to operate in an isolated environment. And so finding the ways to do that securely, making sure that up front we're thinking about those things, you know, as we create new opportunities aboard ships or what have you, I think that's the only way. I think that it is certainly achievable. It just has to be, you know, we just have to put security into everything that we're buying, not just the, you know, not just the regular networks, but every one of our technological systems that are out there that have a computer attached to it. So this is just one more area we have to do that in.
So if I could also answer that question and say that we're working to get approval from Admiral Tighe to do this, but we're working in the reserves, and this is part of the Sailor Self-Service IT initiative for Sailor 2025. So we're working to get a Navy Reserve mobile app that would be able to be put on a person's mobile device. So they would have, let's say, their iPhone. They'd have this Navy Reserve app on their phone, have a CAT card reader that would connect to their phone, and that would give two-factor authentication so that you would be able to go into that mobile app, get to your NMCI email, and then get to some of the other systems that we utilize to write orders, to do DTS, to do your PRIMS physical fitness data, your NFAS mustering capability. And so we're working on that right now, and we'll be testing as soon as we get the approval to operate, we're hoping this week. And we'll be going out to 100 users to start the test on this. And so we see that this is the way of the future, because our sailors are a mobile distributed workforce, and they want to be able to connect and get their email. But that email goes to a Navy account, to an NMCI account, and they may not have access to a computer that has that they can get to that email. So this mobile device will allow them to have ready access right in their hand, and they are really excited about it. So we're looking forward to get that approval to operate. At the same time, we're also working a commercial cloud pilot with Microsoft Office 365. And so that we're intending to test with 8,000 users to start, and that will allow our sailors to go from the current storage that they have in their NMCI account of 250 megabytes to 2 terabytes once they get into the Microsoft Cloud environment. It also will allow them to digitally sign and encrypt emails, which they can't do right now through OWA, and it will give them access to the Microsoft suite of products. So this is really a test for Navy, but we're starting with the Navy Reserve because it's a smaller contingent. And as I said, we'll be rolling out a test for 8,000 users sometime this fall.
We've got time for one more question, sir. Thanks for staying. Standing, what do you got?
Hi, Sean Callahan. There's been an ongoing evolution in our understanding of manpower and personnel over the last, say, 15 years, going from straight numbers to aggregated costs. Now we've moved to fit and fill, got granulated programming rates. As we continue to move forward, what do you see as the next generation of, you know, manpower and personnel metrics as we attempt to translate or correlate those to operational readiness and better description of return on investment for those folks?
Sean, it is good to see you again. I didn't recognize you initially, but once you started talking, I knew exactly who I was talking to. Bob, you want to take that on first?
Yes, sir. I'll start with it. So, again, ultimately where we want to go, piggybacking on Admiral White's progressive Navy enlisted classification code idea, that'll, you know, you don't just go to a ship with a code, you go with a code in various phases. So that lets us understand, you know, where the individual sailor's professional development is, even within an individual sea tour. So we've got an idea of where they are. And where we're heading is we want to have fit and fill. We want to have the fit piece, the right sailor with the right training in the right billet at the right time for that tour length. So we want to get down to that level of granularity. That's probably the next stage of that piece. And that's going to have to be, again, it's tied in with our recent change to billet-based distribution for the enlisted force. That is going to be a big enabler for helping us get to that that next phase. And that was a shift that really transitioned our enlisted distribution to be like we do for officers, or like we had done for officers, and we just stood this up in February, and it's fully online, but we're still making adjustments on it. But it's not, you know, X numbers of bodies with X numbers of rates go to the fleet and the fleet divvies them up. It's a sailor with a skill goes to this billet on a ship. So if the ship chooses to move them, they can still do that, but they have to be careful now because they may not get a fill for a sailor with that skill set. So where we used to be able to do a lot more, you know, stacking the deck in one area or another on a particular ship, and then sending a false demand signal to the system, that won't be possible under billet-based distribution. So it gives us an overall macro accurate picture, helps us streamline our production coming in up front, and also the types of sailors, the types and numbers of sailors that we're bringing in from recruiting command. It's more of a real-time picture.
Okay. I really appreciate the great dialogue and the questions that came from the audience today. I hope you learned something. We'll hang around here for a little bit if you got additional questions. Let me just close with the reason this topic is so important, inside and outside the technological discussion we're going to have on the floor, we have been having on the floor, is we have had the great privilege of extraordinary recruiting and retention over the last 15 years. Really feeding off of the passion to want to serve our country post 9/11. That is starting to taper off. A long time to be in a fight. Generations are changing, as we talked about. Next year, Jeff Hughes will recruit young men and women who walk through the doors of Great Lakes who were born after 9/11. Think about that. So that's going to be in the distant past for a lot of our kids. What we're trying to get out in front here is this shift in generations, expectational change, technology that's outpacing our ability to train, recruit, and retain the kind of talent we need to keep the Navy moving ahead of our adversaries. All this is critically important, as critical as what technology is bringing on the floor that you'll see downstairs. So I appreciate all the questions and your attendance today, and I hope we answered some of those, and we'll hang around here for a little bit if you've got some more. Thank you very much.